I'm not in what
turn.
How do
you make sure you
don't go?
Anybody else wants to sign in, please? Anybody?
What are we signing for?
Do you want to speak?
Yeah.
Okay, you can do it right up here.
Would you like to say something, sir? Yes, young man, right here.
If anybody else wants to sign in, please. Several of you have walked in, and we need you to sign in if you would like to speak. Can everybody hear me? There are plenty of seats up front. There are many seats up front. Please move up front if you would, please. We're ready to start here in just a minute. If everybody could find a seat. If you want to speak, we need you to sign in. Just tell us your name and address, and we'll call you in order, please. We have plenty of seats up front here. People walking in. Come on up the front, please. If you would like to speak, we would ask you to sign in right here at the table.
Yeah.
Would any of y'all like to speak?
Hello.
Would y'all like to say anything? You need to go ahead and sign up now. You will not be called if you're not signed in, please. Can y'all hear me in the back okay?
No.
Cannot? Randy Knighton, can you show around? Okay. Test 1-2, test 1-2. Can you hear that?
Okay. Stay on it.
Dr. Phil, Dr. Bush, would y'all like to say anything? If you would, we need you to sign in, if you would, please. Right up here at the front table. Right here in the front. A few more seats up front if anybody would like to sit in them.
If we decide not to say anything, we don't have to.
Just wave at me, Dr. Bush.
I'm an old cyclist.
You mean recycling?
The recycling?
Yeah.
The
recycling.
How's
your cycling?
How's
Why don't we go ahead and get the meeting started, and thank y'all for coming. It means a lot to the delegation here, Representative Dunahoo, Representative Hawkins, and myself. I wanted you to know what has happened over the last few years in the legislature. I have received in the last 2 years, seems like 200 years, the last 2 years, over 200 complaints on both sides of the aisle as far as cyclists, also motorists, and property owners. At the end of this session, I dropped the bill to carry over this for this interim to discuss it. I was quite surprised. It lay dormant for 6 months, and then the last couple of weeks it lit up. Let me give you a little process of how the legislature works. First of all, you have to draft a bill up. I drafted a bill up, and I put a lot of things in it, hopefully getting everybody's attention. And based on the capacity in the room, we've gotten everybody's attention. Over the last 2 weeks, I've been called every name possible in the dictionary. And that's okay. That's the process we go through. We would like to hear from you, the cyclists, what can we do for you to protect you? The motorists, the property owner, what can we do for you? We keep saying it's a safety issue. It is a safety issue. The sport is obviously booming and continuing to boom. And I'm hearing from people all over Northeast Georgia about the concerns they have. And I was going to read some of the emails as well. In the legislature, we introduce the bill. It goes to a committee. It has been assigned to the committee, but I have not asked for any hearing. Don't plan to until we get through with this. We want to find out, as three reps, what you need. I know a lot of you are against the bill, and that's fine. A lot of you are for the bill, and that's fine. But we need to bring common sense back to cycling, to motorists, road rage that occurs by cyclists and also by motorists. So we will begin the process. I'll ask Representative Hawkins, do you have anything to say? And Representative Dunahoo.
Thanks, Carl. Carl came to me the last night of the session, and his words were, this is a piece of legislation that addresses what we've heard from angry motorists. Nothing in the bill really for cyclists is mainly what we heard from motorists. My concern here is what I've heard, and what I've heard are comments like, I'm tired of getting over, they're slowing me down, things of that nature. Now, wait a minute. That is from a few motorists. I've also heard from a few cyclists that say, you know, I deserve the road as much as a car. So we got both ends of the spectrum. And I'm not saying any, you know, one or the other. But what I am saying is we need to have safety. We don't need people getting hurt because of a passing car. We don't need people getting hurt because a cyclist runs through a stop sign. We don't need people having things thrown at them. What we need is a good, safe sport that everybody enjoys, and we all get along and make the road safe for everyone.
And I want to say that thank you for coming, and I really do mean that. I've probably had 90% have been very professional on emails, understanding that I've had the privilege of talking to probably 100 people, answering emails of probably a couple hundred. I've only pretty much answered, not professionally, one or two, and I apologize to them. But, you know, the biggest thing we're looking at is I've had people tell me that 7 o'clock in the morning they've got cyclists coming in fog. And then you think, well, I've been in situations where I didn't get mad at them because I looked at, well, these are friends of mine that cycle. I don't want to have to bury one. I've had to bury several that I know, a couple from my church, a couple from local areas. And the biggest thing is, I looked at this bill with one intent, to bring the constituents here to talk and work out a problem, not to sit here and argue. I'm not trying to pass a bill by no means to regulate another tax. I do not believe that there's ways we're going to win until the people get together and they talk. We listen, we grow, and leave here, because if we don't leave here with some object of objection positive, what we're going to have is we're going to have a bill that will surely show up, because I've spoken to enough people that want to see this, and I've had enough on the cyclist side that are upset. All I want to do again is just see everybody come together, come up with some solutions, and let's see if we can't put this behind us.
Okay, if everybody will, when you speak for 2 or 3 minutes, give us your ideas on what we can do to help either side. Conditions, when someone speaks, please allow them to speak. Do not boo them, no applause. Let's respect them, because their time is just as valuable as yours. So, we will begin, and I just saw some people walk in. Does anybody else want to sign up? Ken Robinson, do you want to sign up, or Jenny, you want to sign up to say anything?
No.
You're good? Okay. We'll start off with Pam Miller, who is from Lula, Georgia. And Pam, you want to come to the mic here. And I think it's on. It should be on. And just tell us your name, where you live, and the concerns you have, please, ma'am.
My name is Pam Miller. I live in Lula, Georgia, in North Hall. I am not for or against the proposed bill. I do not know what is included in it. I came here today to voice my concerns for the safety, because most of the roads, especially in the area I live in, are not designed for bicyclists. Most of the roads are very hilly and curvy, which makes it very dangerous. There have been many instances in the past several years where cyclists have been riding in the area I live in, and especially on several of the roads that are very hilly and curvy. I have been in my car and go around a curve or top a hill and have a group of cyclists that are stopped dead still in the road. And many times I've had to hit my brakes, I've had to swerve to the other side of the road, and it's a very big safety issue. I'm not against anybody riding their bicycles, but it concerns me that there could be an instance where I could hit somebody on a bicycle when I go around a curve, and it would not even be my fault. But I could not avoid that if they were sitting dead stop in the middle of the road. And that has happened many occasions around where I live. A couple of weeks ago, going home on the road I live on, there were two cyclists. I got behind them. One of the guys was very, very polite. When there was an area that I could go around them, he got over where I could. However, the other guy rode the center line, and I could not pass him. And he knew I was behind him. He kept turning around looking at me. And that has happened many times. Some cyclists are extremely polite. And I've got a bicycle. I've ridden on the road I live on several times, but it got to the point I was scared because of the cars passing by, and I quit riding it. So it is a very big safety issue for me.
May I ask you a question? What common sense needs to be brought in this issue? I know you've gone through this on a sudden situation. Mm-hmm. Could you see the cyclists when you came upon them, or did they
surprise
you? Most
of the time, no. You know, the roads in my area, they are so very curvy that most of the time you cannot see them until you're right upon them. And it has, there's been several times that either I've had to go over to the side of the road or into the other lane to avoid hitting a cyclist.
Anybody else want to ask her? Okay.
I have a question for her.
Well, you can't answer. You can't answer the question. Not your meeting.
You know, it would be great, and I know the DOT is doing more to build more bike lanes and bike paths. You know, the bad thing is these rural county roads, there's no room for a lot of them, and we don't have them.
So the answer is probably bicycle paths if we had the funding to do it.
I think a lot more bicycle paths would be a big answer.
Yeah. Thank you, Ms. Miller, for coming tonight. Okay, let's see. Jim Walsh, I think Jim's from Lawrenceville, Georgia. Thank you for being here tonight.
Yeah, please. Thanks, Carl. Right now.
You need this mic?
No, I'm good. Can you hear me back there?
I probably can. All
right. Right now, 32 riders like we had in Suwannee on Sunday, riding two abreast would take up 111 feet of space along the road. Car comes up behind us, very easy for them to get by. Gas it and go. And trust me, you motorists, and we're all motorists, this is the thing, it's not A or B. We all drove here, so we know what you're going through. I get behind a garbage truck or a school bus. So we understand what it's like to be back behind bicycles. We want you by as quickly as you want to get by, trust us. And unfortunately, there are some jerks on both sides of the windshield, you know? And the problem is when the two of them come together. But HB 689 would take those 32 riders and go from a from 111 feet to 638. You think we're ticking off drivers now? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your time. All right, Dr. Griffith, I think you wanted to speak. So, this is Dr. Jack Griffith. Lives here in Gainesville, across the lake, and I know he's a big advocate of cycling.
I am. I'm live in North Hall. I moved back to North Georgia in 1994. I'm an oncologist at the medical center. I have a family of five, and it's expanded to eight now. And one of our most favorite family activities is to ride as a group, which we will, you know, under the proposed legislation, we wouldn't be able to do. I am a qualified to speak. I do feel I'm like most Georgia cyclists. I actually do own a car, and I use it a lot too. And of course, I pay taxes on that vehicle. I cycle from 3,000 to 5,000 miles a year. I go various places. Georgia, most of this is in North Georgia, but I've cycled in states all over the country, and then all over the different countries around the world. And I feel like I have strong objections to the proposed law, and you know, you really got some passionate folks out here, and I think you can understand that. Because cycling for us is not just something we do, it isn't just a casual activity, it's a life, it's what we are, it's part of us. What this effort seems to be, to me, it seems to be a knee-jerk reaction to a bad encounter between a motorist and a cyclist. Most of these bad encounters, I do feel that strongly, can be avoided by common sense, courtesy, and patience. I don't think it requires legislation. The legislation under consideration was written, obviously, by a non-cyclist, and if it was written to get the conversation started, it has certainly done that. It is certainly antagonistic to cycling and to the relationship between the cyclist and the motorist. The benefits of cycling in regards to personal health and quality of life are indisputable. When you have the most livable communities in this country and everywhere else, it always, almost always involves a cycling and an attention to that. We need to be doing everything possible in Georgia and particularly in this area to enhance cycling in our community, not discouraging it. Legislative efforts, unlike this one, need to be made to make our highways safer for cyclists and motorists by wider, safer shoulders, bike lanes where it's appropriate, and sloping or flat shoulders. I mean, I would love to commute into town from North Hall, but there's a barrier over there that won't let me do that. The road's plenty wide enough, but when you've got a hard curb, there's nowhere to go if you need to get off the road, and I'm, you know, attuned to that. So it's just really not safe, although people do it. And just in response to the lady who was talking about, I understand what she's saying, you know, I ride up in Lula, and but we love those curvy and hilly roads. That's what we cycle for. That's what we love. Now, dedicated bike trails are not the answer. That's the typical answer given by the non-cyclist. I have commuted to work on dedicated bike trails. I love them. They're wonderful. They're great. But they're not the answer to the problem. We need safer roads, bike lanes where they're appropriate, and we have laws that that regulate the safety out there, stopping, you know, the 3-foot law, which was a great law and been a big help for us, stopping at stop signs. Common sense things are wearing lights and bright clothing, which a lot of us do, and a lot of us use a mirror. So there's some common sense things that we cyclists can embrace, and I think we're, you know, if we want to start this conversation and do that, that'll be great, but that should be done through clubs, through businesses, and through discussion amongst the groups, not through legislation.
Yeah.
About a year ago, I had the opportunity to bring a couple of people that are here, and I think they would attest to you that I saw this happening, and these guys met. One of the things was going to happen a year ago, they were going to go to bicycle shops, they were going to go to rallies, and they were going to present just a small amount of people that are the rebels, the ones that on both sides, that throw a can of tuna fish, as I've had said, out the window, or a bottle from a car, or the bike that shoots the bird to the guy that's riding behind him and knowing he's annoying him. What can we do? Can we start saying that's something to grow on, to where we're going to start taking up as cyclists and just holding the little knuckleheads, as I call them, to be more accountable? Or what do we do? I'm just curious.
Well, I think that this effort that we're part of tonight is brought together the cycling community. I think we're aware, and maybe more aware than ever, that motorists do become irritated, and we need to be mindful of their needs to travel, and we, of course, are going to keep our own safety in mind. So I think the conversations about how we can do that, of course we want to wear bright clothes, we want to wear reflective reflections when we can, and we need to, lights when that's appropriate. I think the conversation has started, and you know, I do believe that cyclists are pretty, since we are so passionate about this, we'll do some things, but you might make a lot of criminals if that law goes through, of us otherwise law-abiding citizens.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Griffin.
Thank you.
There is room upstairs. There's an overflow room on the fourth floor if anybody needs to go there and watch it on the monitor. We have a special guest with us from the Department of Transportation. I was going to let Russell McMurry tell us who he is and what he does for the state of Georgia. On a short notice, Russell was called to come to Gainesville for this meeting. And Russell, why don't you talk about what all the department's doing for cycling?
Thank you, Representative Rogers, and thank you for the opportunity to be here, because you are a big community that we certainly acknowledge. And I think, as you know, over the last year and a half or 2 years, we've actually made strides to address some of those very issues that were just mentioned about making biking safer. I have to tell you today, Bike fatalities are up this year over last, and that's a trend we don't want to continue to happen, so safety is very important. The things that have been going on and the kind of things we've been looking at is, one, is this notion of complete streets. I think everybody's probably on this side of the table has heard about complete streets and understands that to some degree, but it's trying to work complete streets notions into what we do as we go forward. And very simply put, is to try to put the projects that we developed and that we're able to deliver to the public, to all transportation users, but you have to put that in context. So very simply put, as back biking from Claremont, as I believe the gentleman just previously said as I came in, is, you know, shoulders, having bikeable shoulders. Now, does that satisfy everybody? Maybe, maybe not. It's not a dedicated bike lane, but at least we provided an opportunity. That's the kind of things we have to continue to do. That's the kind of things we're focused on to try to do, is look for those opportunities. We've been able to make some strides on some projects that were already under development, that were already maybe under construction, by doing some simple things such as maybe a reduced lane width for vehicles. That's still a safe lane width that provides a little buffer or a little separation for the cyclist. And also, as complete streets goes, this is not bikes, though, right? We have to look at all our users, transit users, look at bus bays or bus pull-offs at stops, and look at the walking community. So we have to address all these as we go forward. Now, you know, you can't turn our aircraft carrier or a couple of aircraft carriers overnight. Projects that we work on, unfortunately, take some time to get through development stages, and we can't flip a switch and change every design overnight. But that's where we're poised to go. That's the kind of things we look at doing. And also, just from the safety point of view, the kind of things that were just mentioned is fantastic. You know, bright colors, lights, you know, all of you as cyclists know those things to do and to be safe. And that's very important, because the safety of you as a cyclist, the safety of you as a pedestrian, the safety of you in your vehicle is very important to all of us at this table, especially Department of Transportation, and we take that charge very seriously. So we actually, as part of that complete streets mentality, is our designers or our consultants that do design work have to take an approach and understand why you cannot include such features, okay, such as pedestrian enhancements or bike enhancements or things that are that you look at in the context of that project. So you have to, instead of starting with a blank slate, you sort of start with everything and work your way back. Now, cost and things like that come into play, right? You have to put it in the context of where you are and what can you deliver for the dollars that you have. But it's really a change in mindset and philosophy over the last few years from the department of looking more comprehensively at projects. And so that's where we are. That's what we're poised to do. And I look forward to the conversation here tonight, and certainly want to learn and understand from all of you here too, concerns, so that we can incorporate that in what we do. So thank you.
Thank you, Russell. Next, Jim Hardman. Jim Hardman obviously is a cyclist and very well known automobile dealer here in Gainesville.
So you guys are here for comments. You know,
Jim, you have 3 minutes.
Okay, you probably think I'm here to oppose this bill, but actually I'm for it. Let me tell you why. We're in serious times. Our government is shut down. We have a bill here that we should not be selfish about. You guys need to take this bill to Washington. You need to take it to Washington because it would accomplish 3 things. One, if you would tax all the bicycles in America, it would raise tens of billions, hundreds of billions of dollars for the federal government. Number two, it would create thousands of jobs in supervising people and instructing people how to ride bicycles. And number three, it would help people, you know, who need instruction. They need a nanny to look out after them. So you should go meet with Nancy Pelosi. And Harry Reid. this bill, seriously, this should, you know, don't be selfish about this. Take it national. This should cover baby strollers, skateboards, wheelchairs, lawnmowers. But I'm serious. Put a tax on everything. You see these shoes? Should the tag be on the left or the right?
Yeah, what about the annual inspection?
So I'm in favor of it. Most people would think, as a car dealer, I would get a tear in my eye to pull up behind somebody on a bicycle. They could be driving a new Buick or a new GMC. But I'm in favor of the bill. I'm on record.
Robert, didn't say where you're from, but I assume you're from Lawrenceville?
Lawrenceville.
Okay.
For the mention of bright colors, for all those who know me, I could not find a yellow suit. I tried. First, I want to personally thank you for your time, genuinely, seriously, and for putting this meeting together. I've got a lot of talking points. Some are in the form of questions. But since we've never met, I want to let you know who I am. I live in Lawrenceville. I've been in Georgia since 1981. I'm a very small business owner. I am a professional cycling coach. I started mycyclecoach.com 10 years ago. My number one concern is safety. I'm the past president of the largest cycling organization in the Southeast, and I've written published monthly cycling articles for the last 5 years. Obviously, I'm a cyclist, but I'm not just any cyclist. To date, I've ridden in excess of 150,000 miles in 16 years. With that many miles, I've seen it all, and I've done almost as much. I've been the victim of a hit and run. I've had crashes that were caused by other cyclists. I've had crashes that were my own fault. I've lost friends who were killed while riding their bike. 1 month ago, a driver pulled in front of us, locked up his brakes, and then pulled a Glock 9mm on us, all because we were riding on the right side of the road. Just 1 month ago, well, actually, that's what I just mentioned. 6 months after I was married, my wife and I were riding a bicycle, and next thing I know, I hear a blood-curdling scream. I literally turn around, and I see my wife literally ragdolling through the air, all because a van, chose to buzz us when the oncoming lane was completely open and clear. Imagine me running up to my bride of 6 months and thinking that she's dead, sprawled out across the road. She had so much road rash on her face that she was unrecognizable. Miscalculating a tight turn up in North Georgia mountains in 2006 resulted in me going literally off the edge of the mountain at 45 miles an hour. And I was left with my left leg filleted open, profusely bleeding, and my right wrist completely bent back and every bone broken. And after several hours thinking I was gonna be one of those 60 minutes or 20-20 stories that you always hear. So I know what's at stake when I clip in. Therefore, understand that my comments are not based on rhetoric, they're not based on theory, they're not based on political agendas, but real life. Point number one, safety. All three of you have mentioned that safety is your concern. Mr. Hawkins, in an email comment that you gave this week, you said, and I quote, "I signed on to the bill because of my concern with the issue of safety." Respectfully, if that were the case, this town hall meeting should have been held, and many of them, I might add, to allow you to hear from cyclists in great numbers, long before House Bill 689 was ever even drafted, let alone being introduced into legislative session. But now here we are. Please explain to me and to every cyclist in this room why you believe that creating multiple groups of four, as Jim Walsh clearly visibly showed us tonight, riding in a single file, being separated by a minimum of 50 feet is creating a safe environment. And this is for any one of you to respond. Again, if safety is really your concern, please share with us how you voted for House Bill 101, which is better known as the 3-foot law, and explain to us in detail what you have done to further expose and advance the 3-foot law since it was signed into law July the 1st, 2011. Question, if you haven't done anything to literally help the advancement of this law, which clearly increases the safety for cyclists and would fulfill your stated concern for our safety, why would you ever expect me or any other cyclist in this room to believe that any other bill that is clearly not safe for cyclists would make any difference, would make any difference other than the 3-foot law? The majority of our state law enforcement doesn't even have a clue about the 3-foot law and therefore can't enforce it. How in the world would you get the police to enforce your bill? And before you answer, a cycling friend of mine was riding in Hall County last week. He was pulled over by a deputy. And after very forceful words from the Hall County deputy, the deputy actually backed down when my friend actually cited the law to the deputy. And he explaining him that he had the legal right to ride in whatever part of the lane he deemed safe for specific conditions. Oh, by the way, that deputy has received official counseling from his superiors. I can give you many more examples, but without the sake of time. Point number two, tag fees and registration. The following questions are for any of you. Number one, your bill does not distinguish between a $10,000 carbon road bicycle and a Target or Walmart $100 bicycle. Therefore, if I were a parent and bought a Walmart bicycle for my child, your bill would force me to register this bicycle for more than 10% of its actual cost. And if I did not, then you would fine me $100. We already know the answer to this question, but we want to give you the chance to share your perspective on number one, how would this affect future bicycle purchases for these institutions? And number two, how would you explain to the retailers as this being good business? Not to mention the loss of revenue, which is ultimately tax dollars. Since your bill has explicit requirement to provide a valid civic address during the registration process, how would you make it possible for homeless people to comply with the law unless the state of Georgia provide them with free housing within 30 days of becoming homeless, which is not provided for your bill? I could specifically describe to you countless crashes of cyclists where part of their physical injuries were actually caused by coming into contact with parts of their bicycle. But for the sake of time, I won't. With your bill, all bicycles would have a tag, and I quote from your bill, at least 4 inches wide and not less than 7 inches in length. And my guess it would be the same material used as our vehicle tags. Back to your stated concerns of cyclist safety, why would you introduce a bill requiring a metal type object to be required to be mounted on a bicycle and therefore become a real and legitimate object that could cause serious physical injury and in a worst case scenario, potentially cut a main artery in a crash and become fatal? Is this what the state is really ready to handle for the type of lawsuits that is almost assuredly to come? There's countless charity events that collect broken and unused bicycles and refurbish them and give them to underprivileged children. Do you expect a charity to go and register each bicycle, pay a registration fee or a transfer fee, mount tags to each one, distribute them to the deserving children, and then who in the world is going to propose to keep track of each bicycle so the registration fees are renewed every 5 years? What are you proposing would be a potential literally shutdown for incredible organizations that are trying to make a positive influence in children's lives? What possibly would you say to them to justify your bill? And then finally, the right to assemble. Your bill states, and I quote, when a roadway is part of the state highway system, the Department of Transportation may restrict persons from riding bicycles on the roadway or designate certain times when bicycle riding is permissible. And it's the same for the local. Everyone in this room knows exactly what this means and opens up the door to our government telling us where and when we can and cannot ride our bicycles. Forget that every other absurd component of this bill. This verbiage telling us when and where we can ride our bicycles is a direct violation of free society. I promise you that the cycling community will not sit back and let this happen. Last time I checked, the state of Georgia is in the United States. And if my history is correct, we're in a free society. Our government is here to provide its citizens protection from all enemies, foreign and domestic, and to uphold the Constitution.
Yes.
You are not in the bicycle recreation business. Every cyclist in this room and across this state will make sure that that does not happen. There's charity rides that are from March to October, almost every weekend in this state. Many of them are staged in and around small towns, provide tremendous revenue to local businesses. I've even started my own event on behalf of a rare disease that my wife has. In my experience, living my entire life in this country, anytime the government, whether local, federal, or state, is given the ability to institute restrictions or limitations on its citizens, it has always done so, and in even more than anticipated. And if Mr. Siphon is present, those whose name seems to come up every time there's serious complaining about cyclists in Hall County, I would ask you to share with us cyclists the specific details behind your recent statement to the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, and I quote, "I can't tell you the times I've just about had to hit the ditch because of a cyclist." Every cyclist here is waiting with bated breath to hear how someone riding on a bicycle that weighs approximately 17 pounds, wearing only spandex clothing and a helmet, without the protection of multiple airbags, surrounded by 1,000 pounds of steel and seat belts, could possibly cause you, who does have the protection of airbags, seat belts, and steel, to be so physically threatened that you about had to hit the ditch.
You want me to do it?
My
now?
Guess is that from your description, I could probably cite countless issues where you were either not patient enough to pass safely, or you were just inconvenienced too long for your own liking. There are cyclists that break. There are cyclists that break laws in this state.
Robert, that's
enough. I'm going to close with suggestions. Y'all need to speak?
Yeah!
Yeah. Do y'all yield your 3 minutes?
Yeah, the marshal's going.
I yield my 3 minutes.
I understand. I've got some real suggestions. 30 seconds. 30 seconds?
No.
Okay.
Come on.
Next person,
guys.
A lot of people here want to speak. Let's let everybody get
sure.
Today.
That's
cool.
Sure.
Okay.
Alright, can you answer his question?
Ma'am, if you would be quiet, please. Thank you. I'm trying to be as courteous as I possibly can. And the marshals are here to escort you out. I'm sorry, but we've got to keep order. Thank you.
Yeah.
I want to hear from John Coyle. John's from...
What about answer his question?
No.
You're
going to
ask him?
We're here for a public hearing. I'm here to hear from you.
I will
be glad to meet with him later on. Mr. John Coyle. I'm sorry? We're trying to keep an orderly meeting. I'm sorry. John's an advocate, bicyclist, grew up here in Gainesville. Good to see you.
Just one second, guy. That's very disappointing.
Robert's a friend of mine. He sat down, so it's very disappointing that you guys had him escorted out. That's all I'm going to say about it. That's all I'm going to say about it.
Thank you, John. But if you'll go ahead and talk about your 3 minutes, please.
I will.
Thank you.
Just like everybody said in here, it's all about safety. I'll tell you my quick story. This year, actually, I was hit by a vehicle. When I was on my bicycle, I was by myself, riding in Gwinnett County. Had a gentleman decide to pass me with cars stopped on the other side of the road. Obviously, you know where that went from there. There's not enough space for a bike, a car, and other cars. The driver drove off. Luckily for me, there were a lot of people around, and somebody followed the gentleman to his house, got his tag number. We found him later. I was talking to the police after the fact, again, about the 3-foot rule, and they looked at me like, what are you talking about? There's a 3-foot rule in Georgia? And these are you know, Loganville police officers. They didn't even know there was a 3-foot law. Once they found out there was a 3-foot law in Georgia, they prosecuted the gentleman. I think he got probation and community service. I don't know. It wasn't a very big punishment. Luckily for me, my injuries weren't too bad. I'm still recovering from them. Here's what I would say. We have a law in place that's a very good law. But we don't educate people. Is the 3-foot law in the driver's education manual? I doubt it, but it needs to be. 2 years ago, teenager in Gwinnett County, a guy that I rode with, he's riding by himself, the teenager just runs him over and kills him. I guarantee if you ask that teenager, did he know that there was a 3-foot law in Georgia when you passed a cyclist, he would say no. So I think we need to look at education, and I think we need to look at, you know, how do cars and bikes interact? I can tell you right now, bikers do not want to be around cars. We do everything within our power. We pick when we ride, we pick where we ride. We try to not be involved with cars. Now that, obviously you can't do that all the time. Cars have to go places, we're trying to go places. So this legislation was obviously not crafted by any bikers because it totally does the wrong thing. It totally makes it less safe. And it makes it more dangerous for not only bikers, but it makes it more dangerous for cars, other pedestrians, you know, mothers with strollers, dogs. That's another thing people probably don't know. You know, you got to keep your dog in your yard. I had a buddy of mine about 2 months ago. Dog comes out, runs in front of us, boom, down to the pavement, knocks 5 teeth out. So there's a lot of education that needs to go along with, you know, this conversation. So what I would suggest you guys do, if you want to do something for safety, go back to the table, get some motorists together, get some cyclists together, have a conversation, talk about what can and can't be done, what makes sense, and then do something.
That's right.
John, you've had other accidents, I've been told by your father. He mentioned 3 others.
Sure, railroad tracks that aren't marked, those are great for cyclists. Yeah. ran into a couple of those about a year and a half ago and broke my pelvis. So we cyclists have all kinds of things to look out for. So, you know, that's another problem. I contacted the railroad on that and they're like, oh, we have those all over the place. We really can't fix it. Well, it didn't do me any good. Me and 3 other guys, broken pelvises, boom.
Okay. Same day. Thank you. You want to comment on railroad tracks? That's something I hadn't heard before.
And absolutely, and it's cool. It sounds like you did the right thing. Actually, railroad tracks are not in our jurisdiction or our city, or county, or Georgia DOT. The railroad's actually on those crossings. Contacting the railroad is the right thing to do. I would comment on the notion and the comment on the education, and that goes back to the previous comment or two, is what can you do for education and 3-foot rule? Georgia DOT is not really in the enforcement business, but we are in the education business, and that's important. I can commit to you today that we will take the education of the 3-foot rule of law and be proactive in trying to get that message out. We're working right now on a distracted driver. That's another issue nobody's mentioned yet, of just distracted drivers in general while you're out cycling and somebody's texting while they're driving. That's another thing that gives us great concern today. So that's certainly something we can work on and commit to work on through education. But that education is all of us, right? It's a team effort to educate everybody on both sides. So certainly don't mind taking that on.
Okay, we have many more to go. Roger Fitzpatrick from Cleveland, Georgia. Roger? Roger's a retired educator, if I remember right, and a retired Marine.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you. I'm going to approach this from a little bit different perspective. Our founders felt like issues needed to be dealt with at the location at which it could best be addressed. If it's a national issue, then deal with it at the national level. If it's a state issue, deal with it at the state level. If it's a local issue, deal with it at the local level. And you know, I live in White County, and we're nowhere near as populated as Hall County. And you know, there are counties in South Georgia, I would say, that are even more sparsely populated than White County is. And it seems to me like this is just an overreaching piece of legislation that would be better suited for either local municipalities to address if need be. And let me say this, I'm not a cyclist. I've got a bicycle in my garage, and you know, and maybe two or three times a year I might pull it out and ride it up and down the road. I approach this more from a perspective of liberty. And we need to have the liberty, which is an inalienable right, to be able to go where we need to go, where we want to go, when we want to go, without any encroachment on the government on that inalienable right. And I would suggest that if something needs to be done, it needs to be addressed to either the city council level, where we have a little bit more influence than we would at the state legislature. You know, I appreciate you three having this hearing, but you know, we have a whole lot less influence with the state legislature than we would with our five city councilmen or our five county commissioners. So let's deal with it at the place where it needs to be addressed, not at the state level. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to call on Dr. Chuck DeArmond to come speak. Dr. DeArmond is a retired educator, and he's probably been cycling 25, 26 years. And Dr. DeArmond, I'm glad you made it. So.
Still short. Thank you, Carl. I used to have the old spoke and pedal bike shop here in Gainesville a long time ago. I've been riding for a long time, solo rider mostly. I don't ride in groups. What I have found the biggest problem to be is the lack of shoulder on the road. I think a lot of the problems could be rectified just by having shoulders on some of the roads that the riders like to ride. So that's kind of where I'm coming from. If we had more access and we get off the road, that would be great. Thank you.
Mr. Michael Casper, I know Mike's here and an advocate, so thank you for being here tonight, Mr. Mike Casper.
With all due respect, gentlemen, I'd like to challenge the assertion that you drop a bill in the hopper and then you take public comment. I'd like to ask any of the three of you what input you got for this legislation other than Jim Siphon. I don't know if Jim came up with the taxation angle. That may have come from you, Carl.
Are Are you through speaking?
What you have done is you've polarized the community on this issue. And now you're stuck with it. Well, so we're all here, and now you're going to have to take a step backwards and do what should have been done before, which is bring two groups together to work for the common good. But right now, you guys are stuck with the mess that y'all have created.
Mike Wall, you ready to say something?
It would just be redundant.
Okay.
I would like to talk about, you know, you brought up how, homeowners.
Do you want to bring up, come to the mic?
Well, I mean, yeah, I've been cycling for over 35 years, so
good.
North Georgia, most of my life, so everything they say is true, but one thing we haven't talked about a lot is, you know, leash laws. You know, I had broken ribs, broken hip, concussion, no fun, only because the dog just ran out and took us down. Right? This happens all the time.
Yes.
All the time. And let's start with, you know, the laws that are in place, enforcing them, and not create other laws when we've got laws now that we should be enforcing. That's all I'm saying.
How about Beverly Bryant in from Lawrenceville? Ms. Bryant?
My name is Beverly Bryant. I'm from Lawrenceville, Georgia. I just have a few points to make. I've been an adult cyclist since 1986, and I've been doing week-long rides ever since my first brag in 1999. I've had objects thrown at me. I've been yelled at, people yell out, get a car. You know, of course, by the time I yell out, I've got one, thank you very much. But I do want to say that when it comes to motorists and cyclists, there are mistakes on both sides. There are rude motorists, there are rude cyclists. I'm both. I mean, I'm not a rude cyclist, but I'm both a motorist and a cyclist, and I do see that there are mistakes made on both sides. I get as angry as anyone else when I see a cyclist out doing stupid things, illegal things, running stop signs. I want to yell at them, share the road. Because share the road, a lot of cyclists don't understand. Share the road means you're sharing too, not just the motorist. It's not just the motorist that has to make way for the cyclist. The cyclist has to make way for the motorist as well. Another thing is, I feel like a lot of motorists, when a cyclist does something stupid, it sticks in their mind. Stupid cyclist. All cyclists are stupid. All cyclists are rude. Well, if a VW, say, pulled out in front of me in traffic, am I going to say that all VW drivers are stupid? All VW drivers are rude? No. But it's a perception that gets stuck in people's brains. Another thing I'd like to say is I read an online comment and someone said a cyclist can cause a motorist to end up in a ditch or in the front end of another vehicle. But if a motorist did so passing another motorized vehicle, was it that motorized vehicle's fault that somebody tried to make an improper pass, tried to pass on a curb, tried to pass on a hill? No. It is an improper pass. It is incumbent upon the person doing the passing to do so safely. If he can't, he's supposed to wait. I'm sorry. Another point I'd like to make is I really feel for the woman who almost hit the cyclist because I've been in that situation and I do get aggravated with the cyclist who, they get a flat tire, they stop in the middle of the road. That is not safe cycling. As soon as you realize that there's a reason to stop, get off the pavement. Get off the pavement. Get off the pavement. Okay. And telling a road cyclist that you can ride on the path. Well, that's like telling a professional football player, well, you don't have to get out there in all that equipment. Why don't you just play touch football? That's what it's like. You don't understand unless you've done it. Unless you've gone out and you've ridden 100 miles in one day. You've gone out and you've ridden from city to city to city for a whole week. You don't understand the difference between getting on a path and passing the little kids on their trikes and passing the roller skaters and trying to pass the people that are jogging. It's different. It's totally different. It's like the difference between professional football and touch, what do they call it, flag football. I'm sorry, I'm not a football player. Hardly, my analogy is not exact. And the one other thing I do want to say is, and I think Robert mentioned this as well, there are so many rides out there for charity. And believe me, this law would cripple those rides. They would end because they cannot, these rides cannot afford the official, the liability to officially sanction a ride with such unreasonable expectations. And I think that covers me. Thank you.
Wesley Robinson. I know Wes is here. I saw him come in.
He left.
He did? Okay. Dr. Phil. Tommy Till.
First off, I'm a little ashamed of what went on a while ago. And
I saw you, Dr. Phil. If you go ahead and present your what you want to say.
It's kind of like when I was a doctor one time and I wanted to ask him a question. He said, you're too upset to discuss that. I was after he said that.
We do have a lot of people that want to talk. So.
I understand. I've been in Gainesville since 1976. I've been cycling here for 35, 40 years. In North Georgia, up in up on the curvy roads up in North Georgia, which is what it's all about to a cyclist, to ride up in those roads. What it's all about is to get a nice afternoon ride. We talk about this was about for safety. Who in this room do you think wants more safety than these bikers? They are interested in safety. I love cycling. I don't want to die cycling. I don't want to die because somebody passed at the wrong time. I don't want to die because somebody did something else wrong. I want to enjoy my sport, but I want to do it in a reasonable manner. People mentioned about somebody might pull off the road and stop their bike in the middle of the road. Obviously, not something anyone should do. One saying, but you can't fix stupid. If a car passes somebody, I did a little research because, you know, talked about safety, and you said that there's been an increase in the number of fatalities in Georgia. Well, nationwide, there's actually been a reduction in fatalities by bikers over the last 5 years. Now, Georgia may be the exception right now, and I'd certainly like to change that because I live in Georgia. But I looked up also trying to find some of the deaths in Georgia over the last year, and I was able to find about four or five of them. I think, I'm not sure the correct number. One was a child that 14-year-old boy rode out of his driveway, was hit by a police car driving down the road. That's one of the deaths. One of the other deaths was a preacher who was riding along the road, on the side of the road, and he was hit. We haven't heard what happened. Another one was a large bus which was driving along the road, had two people in it, didn't have any passengers in it. Biker was on the road outside the white line. He was hit and killed. The bus driver was charged with following too close and with following too close, and I can't remember what the other thing, but is a, oh, excuse me, second degree vehicular manslaughter. Does anybody know what a second degree vehicular manslaughter is? It's a misdemeanor. This guy is dead. He's got two kids. The bus driver was at fault. He's got a misdemeanor. I'd like to see something made so that somebody who is making a mistake like that kill somebody has something slightly more long-lasting than misdemeanor. Thank you.
Kelly Campbell. Ms. Campbell, if you could try to keep it as short as possible, please.
I'm good.
Thank you.
I'm a cyclist. I'm a very social cyclist. I only log probably 1,000 miles a year, but I have fun. And I just, it's all scattered, but I'll say a couple things that I wanted to say. One thing that nobody has mentioned yet is same rules, same rights. I'm all about the same rules. With that comes the same rights and the same consequences. So when we do have irresponsible cyclists and irresponsible motorists, they should be ticketed. We have enough laws. There is no possible way for every motorist, every cyclist, every police officer, every gun owner, there's no way to be able to know and recite every single law. But the laws that are there and that are out there and publicized and known, they should be enforced with those consequences. What else is I gonna say? I don't, like I said, I'm not a very, I guess I don't log a whole lot of miles in, but I actually avoid a lot of organized group rides because I'm a little slow. I don't ride as often as a lot of my friends here. But I avoid the organized group rides. And by doing that, I do ride solo most of the time if I'm not riding in an organized event like Bragg was mentioned earlier, which automatically puts me at a disadvantage. I'm automatically by myself. I'm slower. If I do have some sort of mechanical issue, I'm pulling off to the side of the road, possibly down in a ditch, so I'm off the pavement, but I'm by myself. Another thing is I'm not as easily visible if I'm by myself, so it would be a lot safer in a larger group. I think somebody mentioned this courtesy, common sense, and patience for everybody. That's not just motorists and cyclists, little kids, old people, everybody, you know. Everybody could have a little bit more of that. And as far as riding on the paths and the bike lanes, if they were properly maintained, that would be fantastic. We have lots of problems with rumbles and gravels, potholes, things like that. It's not always realistic to use the shoulder for every single road. And as far as the path goes, that is great for recreational, kind of slower ride. I have ridden the entire Silver Comet multiple times. But for everyday cycling, that's not realistic for all of us. I don't know that that's really within the taxpayers' dollar to have a path everywhere for us. I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Tracy Kennedy from Dahlonega.
Another short person. I'm not a professional cyclist, but I do have some concerns and on the negative effects of the proposal. You have many families that have small children, and they have many small children, and for them to incur fees for every bike that they have in their family, I think that's a little obnoxious. It's an exercise source. It's something you want to encourage in children to do, and if it winds up being a problem in cost, then the families will stop doing it. The guy that was up here from Cleveland, I agree with him. I don't know why you would want to handle this on a state level rather than in a local level where the problems are occurring. And going to the guy that brought up about the leash laws, I don't see a state legislation for dogs. So there's also a hint of abusive power to this bill. It's like a get back for bad behavior by one individual that made somebody angry. And I think that's just purely an abuse of power. They want to be able to get back somebody who makes them angry. You also have people who would be sick or elderly that keep bikes in their garages for years and years and years and pass them on to family after, you know, they haven't used them. And to apply a fee to those that are sitting up in garages and make them register just seems kind of ridiculous. Those who cannot afford vehicles and use bikes to get your maintenance and fee-free transportation to get to low-income jobs are going to be penalized by it and cause more hardship where they already have enough. And there's also the tourist industry who would suffer from it if you make a negative environment. Again, you have not just tourists, but you have fans as well that go to sponsored events. So that's it.
Well, I'm not as humorous as Jim Hardman, but my family, I'm Chad Hayes. My family owns five businesses in North Georgia, car businesses, which is why I say that. My family lives in Flowery Branch. I have a wife and two daughters, and we all cycle and mountain bike. We're really active. We do all the triathlons that go on in this area. We love them. All the mountain bike races. We love anything outdoors. Love getting out. Love getting out on the roads. The roads in North Georgia are awesome. The weather, the mountains. Love the mountains. So I'm an avid cyclist. So I also help organize the Lieutenant Governor's ride, and I'm the ride director. I don't have a teleprompter, so I'm going to read this. First of all, the license plates on bicycles, it won't work. I'm an accountant. It works, so I did a lot of research. Other communities in the U.S. have tried to license bicycles and found that the cost vastly exceed any revenue raised, and they've abandoned the concept. So you can do a little research, figure that out. It's not going to work. It's a pipe dream to think that you're going to be able to pay for bike lanes or extra law enforcement or whatever if you put a tag on a bike. It's not going to work. Another problem I have with the 689 and anything really that tries to restrict cycling is we have a big enough problem in Georgia with the health of our citizens. Right now, according to healthyamericans.org, 65.3% of our population is obese or overweight. I don't think restricting cycling in any way would help that. So speaking of exercise, the packs of riders that ride in groups, I hear complaints about group rides taking up space on roads for recreation, and it kind of reflects the view that driving trips are serious trips and bike trips are not, they're just optional. And that's not true. Drivers who drive on the road and who come up behind, they're not going to work and coming back. They're going to the gym. They're doing whatever, you know, they're going to the mall. So it's just not, it's not a good argument to say. Now here's what I will admit that we have a problem. And this I'll address to the cyclists in the room. You guys know we have a problem. We've already talked about it in here. There are cyclists that don't adhere to riding in two abreast. They stretch out all over the road. They don't care. It's up to us to police that, right? So if you're if you're strong enough to be here and think that, then you're strong enough to be in the group ride and tell those guys to get in line. And if you're strong enough to be here, you're strong enough to look back and say, hey guys, let's single up because there's a whole bunch of traffic back here. Let's let them all pass. You be captains out there because this is the problem, part of the problem. So you guys get it straight, and everybody will start thinking cycling is beautiful in Georgia, which it is, because Georgia's beautiful. All right, so here's my recommendations. Instead of this law or any other stuff you guys are thinking about, the in order to reach out to educate cyclists and educate motorists, there's a great organization in Georgia called georgiabikes.org. If you go to their website, they have tons of stuff. One of the great things they have is a booklet, a pocket guide. And if you can get that pocket guide into everybody's hand who buys a bicycle, you would be influencing them. You'd be the guy that just says, hey, you know what? I'm tired of Pilates. I want a bike now. And he's the guy that might be messing up out on the road. You go ahead and give him something. So if you want to work on something, work on getting the state to put that in every bike shop in the whole state to hand out to and make it mandatory. Walmart needs to make it mandatory. All right? Now, in 2 weeks, from October 18th to 20th in Roswell, the GeorgiaBikes.org will host a Georgia Bikes Summit. And they bring together advocates, elected leaders, transportation officials from across the state for workshops and discussion on how to make Georgia a bicycle-friendly state. And I give money to them. I wouldn't give it to you, but I give it to them. Bicycling fatalities, unfortunately, according to my research, rose in Georgia in 2012. And we all know why. Because there's more of us than ever. And we're growing. So it's a growing problem, not a problem, it's a growing opportunity in my business. It's a growing opportunity. And we need to address it with the right things. And you're all Republicans, so you'll understand my next thing. If Atlanta's mayor, Kasim Reed, recently announced the city will double its miles of bike lanes and multi-use trails in 2016 and just approved $2.5 million for high-quality bicycle projects that will help achieve a network of safe and convenient and connected bikeable streets and facilities. Last year, when the rates of fatalities increased, Atlanta had none. No fatalities. Now, there's people that would ask, why do I care about having a bike-friendly community? It doesn't benefit me. It's not true. I did a little bit of research, and I found out that the Silver Comet Trail, from Smyrna to Alabama, west of Cedartown, generates approximately $57 million in economic benefit to the state of Georgia. So, and there's plenty of other stories like that in counties and around this state with paths and doing the work. Now, obviously, the DOT has already said what they're doing with complete streets. We need to support that. And then the last thing I'll say is right here in Hall County, and many counties have the same thing, there's this thing called the Gainesville Hall Metropolitan Planning Organization. And this group has developed a plan for bicycle and pedestrian mobility. They have created a bicycle network that uses the state-designed bicycle route along Hog Mountain Road, Atlanta Highway, Clark's Bridge Road, as a trunk line from which to build, employing things like separate striped bike lanes on roads with adequate right-of-way, wide curb lanes on lower automotive traffic volume roads, multi-use paths between corridors. Existing town centers have sidewalks that could be expanded, natural waterways and rail corridors for multi-use trip. So they've created this plan, an extensive and highly researched plan to make it possible to provide safe access between schools and parks and downtowns. And it's already been endorsed by every local jurisdiction in Hall County. So they already all agree we'd love to do this. So what does it need? Funding. That's all it needs, funding. So we can start working on those things. We got the cooperation of the DOT, we got all these things out there. They just need funding. So, gentlemen, I'm instead of blaming the victims of cycling accidents, let's support safer streets that keep you from being inconvenienced and me from being incapacitated. Let's support things that I've spoken about here today. It's the best way with the increase of cyclists on the roadways, but it has a bonus of positive economic impact and a promotion of healthier lifestyles, especially in Hall County. I'm real excited. We're going to have a Georgia High School Cycling League in Georgia. And my daughter, she could let her in cycling. It's awesome. I can't wait. There's only one way to go, and everybody wins if we'll shift our efforts to the promotion of healthy lifestyles, complete streets, GeorgiaBikes.org type advocacy, and funding of plans that create it all. The state legislature should be spending time to work with these entities to assist with these efforts and not on unworkable regulations that just create more animosity between cars and bicycles. Thank you for having this.
Thank you. Amy Booker. And Amy, is Jay with you?
Yes.
Okay. You both come up. Jay Mark Nalter, is that right?
Close.
Okay, close. Right.
Good evening. I'm Amy Booker, president of the Dahlonega Lumpkin County Chamber of Commerce, and I do have with me Jay Mark Walter, our tourism director, and Stephanie Logsdon, our VP of operations. And I want to say thank you to each of you tonight for holding this meeting, and I respectfully want to say thank you for your service. Thank you very much for what you do. The reason that we'd like to talk with you tonight is in regards to economic impact. I think you are all aware that tourism has a tremendous economic impact on our region. It certainly does to Lumpkin County. As a matter of fact, tourism is probably one of our major industries. And when we talk about job creation, it creates a whole lot of jobs in Lumpkin County, which I know is very important to all of us. Not only do we serve as the destination marketing organization for the community, looking to attract visitors to the community, we also hold an event. It's now become the largest ride in the Southeast. It's called the Six Gap Century and Three Gap 50. We've worked really hard to grow this ride. We're very blessed with a lot of assets in our community to attract visitors, but certainly the natural beauty is huge, and cyclists love to be outdoors on their bikes in that natural beauty. And the mountains, I wish I had the stamina to be able to ride them, but they love that challenge, and that takes them to the pinnacle of their goals, is to be able to train and prepare for an event like our Six Gap Century, which is a 100-mile ride and a 50-mile ride. I would like to share some numbers with you. On a conservative estimation, just the weekend of Six Gap, we generate $1.35 million of economic impact to our community. And that does not factor in all of those weekends. We have a database of cyclists, about 10,438 emails. And as you have received a lot of emails, we're receiving a whole lot of emails from our cyclist community. And they're telling us, these cyclists, they come from 31 states and four countries just to participate in Six Gap. A lot of them are from Florida. They don't have the hills to be able to train on. They tell us in surveys that they come to our community numerous times throughout the year. We calculate that the average amount that they spend, they don't come alone, they come with their families. They're spending money in our restaurants and in our shops. And we happen to note that they're very good stewards to the community. They happen to be very clean, environmentally friendly people. We started, this is our third year of holding a criterium, which is a very fast-paced race in downtown Dahlonega. And the community was a little bit concerned, our city and county government, about making sure that everything was kept clean. So we went above and beyond, and we hired extra staff from the city to come to clean up and make sure that we were leaving it really pristine. And honest to goodness, the employees of the city, they stood around and said, "My goodness, there is nothing to do here. This is the cleanest group of people we have ever worked behind." So. Few of the positive things. We know there's challenges. Certainly, there's people that there are great laws that are in place, and I know that law enforcement constantly has to stay on top of what those laws are. And it's very important. I've heard a lot of people talk about education, and to be good stewards of our community, we're very supportive of that, and we would like to be a partner in that. We feel like there can be more to be able to communicate what those laws are, both for motorists and for the cyclists. We can, if we just have a little bit of patience, I think, share our roadways. And I have some questions that I can't really pose to you tonight because I know we're not here for that, but I'm not sure out of those 31 states how it will work exactly, because if we're requiring our Georgia cyclists to have license plates, all those people from Tennessee and Alabama and Louisiana and South Carolina, I mean, the list goes on and on. how do they come to participate? Are they going to be ticketed? And in the emails, they're basically saying to us, and I'm not trying to be sarcastic, I promise, but they're saying to us in the emails, we're going to stop coming. I mean, this is anti-cycling is what they're telling us. And they're saying we won't come there to train. We're not going to come there to ride. We won't come participate in Six Gap that we've worked over 25 years to grow to this number. It started with 200 cyclists. We're now at 2,600 cyclists that participate. Safety is a very important concern of ours. And we want to work with Georgia Bikes. And we want to work with our communities and help message so that we can all have good spirit and follow the laws that exist and share our roadways. We may be a ways from there, but we just want you to take into consideration that economic impact that cycling means to our community and I believe to the whole region. Thank you very much.
Lumpkin used all our time.
Okay. I want to thank you for the invitation. And just to reiterate the tourism-based economic development, we've already heard some of those numbers. But, and obviously, 40-inch waist, not a cyclist. And we are, from the chamber and destination marketing perspective, and I serve on the Georgia Mountain Region Tourism Board, this is about the cycles on the bike racks at all the restaurants, at all the accommodations. Just a slice sample of the 25,000 cyclists or so that are training in the mountains. Out of 200, 11 states, 109 cities, 34 from Georgia. I have also worked as a road marshal, so I have seen the aggravation. Mostly getting cussed at by the folks headed to church. Where most of our volunteers are skipping church, who may not even be in support of cycling, but to help the community because of the impact. So these people tell us when they are shuttled back, mostly Floridians trying to handle the mountains, that they come twice, three times, four times a year. The families, the spouses go to Dawsonville to shop, play on Lake Lanier. These are just observations and facts from the tourism perspective, and it's about those adjacent services, job creation, job sustainability. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Is it Alan Edwards from Gainesville, Georgia? Alan?
Hey, thanks for having me. I do, me and my notes, my points have been so eloquently made tonight, so I won't be redundant, but I do want to come with a different perspective. Actually, cycling for me is not a sport. I live out in Gainesville, and we have a lot of hills, and I don't enjoy it. I enjoy half of the hills. You know what I mean? I like going down, but I don't like it. I figured out that any big hill going down, there's always some point I've got to come back up. It's not, I don't like that. I've never ridden in a group. I haven't done it socially. I do it by myself every morning and every evening. I'm out a little later tonight than I normally would be, but I don't normally drive right on this road out here either, but I've been commuting to work for about 2.5 years now. I don't live in town. I live out in Gainesville, and we have tractors out there and hay equipment, and we don't have roads that are really wide enough, but I ride. My wife dresses me like this. She makes sure I've got plenty of bright clothing. I've got these orange shorts, but I couldn't wear them after, well, it would have been good for Georgia, Tennessee. That was good, but I ride about 100 miles a week. That's about, Dr. Lynch reminds me, that's about 5,000 miles a year, and it's really not for pleasure. I don't enjoy a lot of it. I ride year-round. I ride rain or shine. I've ridden when it's snowed. I've ridden when my water bottle is frozen by the time I got to Gainesville. I've ridden in our 109 degrees when I was riding, leaving work to go home on that heat wave we had last summer. So I don't enjoy a lot, but here's my issue. I'm married. I have 3 children. I've got 2 in college. I've got 1 in high school. I've got five vehicles. I've got tags on all of them. Four of them stay on the road all the time. My truck stays sitting as much as it can because that's why I ride my bicycle. I can't afford to put gas in my own vehicle. But I started riding when gas was approaching $5 a gallon. So I'm cheap, so I can pay myself to ride that bicycle. So I get on that thing every morning. I don't like it, but I do it. A big thing, we have plenty of healthcare providers here. I've heard many of them speak, and one thing it has done, I've never had a weight problem, but I've had cholesterol, and it has lowered my cholesterol. And I'm at the perfect level. I don't take any medicine. It's been great. The health issue has been mentioned. And that's an issue I want to talk about was I work at a Christian ministry. It's a free medical clinic here in Gainesville. You know, one of the biggest issues we have, we had some Chinese students stay with us for a while, and they asked me, they said, do you not have any poor people here? And I said, oh, yes, we've got plenty of poor people. That's where I work. I work serving the poor and the needy. And she said, but everyone is so healthy, she said. And said, I guess in other countries, if you're poor, you starve. And our biggest issue at the clinic is obesity. And that obesity drives cardiovascular disease. It complicates diabetes, it complicates hypertension. It complicates issues that we have with pain in the back, knees, ankles, feet, complaints we hear about. The biggest remedy, we give out free medical care, free medicine, but the biggest remedy we talked about, the biggest issue that we try to encourage is diet and exercise. That's a big issue. And I think we're being a little counterproductive if we do anything, if we're trying to recommend, and because we have many patients that get to our clinic solely by a bicycle or walking. So, and many need to be riding that bicycle, but we're being counterproductive. We're telling them, you need to get out and exercise. We're gonna provide you free medical care and prescriptions, and we're gonna do all we can, but I don't know if we can pay for their bicycle license. You know, if they can't pay for the meds, they can't pay for their license to ride a bicycle. I guess that's my big point. Many of the points, but like I said, I will be riding back home tonight. It's about 15 miles probably from here. I will have a bright red flashing light on the back, so be careful.
We've got many more. We've got about 35 minutes to go. Matt Bennett from Swanee's here. Thank you, Matt, for coming up from Swanee.
Thanks for having me. Guys, I'm 44 years old and a lifetime cyclist. Lived in all kinds of parts of this country, and this state has probably got less bike advocacy than any place else that I've lived. The shoulders that you talk about that you're making, the bike lanes, those are great. The other thing you gotta do is you gotta keep them clean. Yeah. Just like the shoulder. We get out there and ride, and there's a bike lane right beside us, but we're not gonna ride through gravel and broken glass and everything else and get flat tires. So keeping those clean as well as putting them down would be great. When I first moved out to San Diego back in the early 90s, I was driving around for one of my first days, and one of the guys that I had moved in with was in the passenger seat. And we were driving down the road, and we went and visited Harbor Island, Shelter Island, and then we were on our way back, and there were bike lanes everywhere. I'd never seen them before. And all of a sudden, we came up to a point where we were gonna turn and take a right. And there was this bike lane, so there was enough room for me to pull the car into it and take a right-hand turn, and I pulled in, and he freaked. He went, whoa, what are you doing? I said, I'm gonna make a right-hand turn at the light. And he said, no, you're gonna get a huge ticket. And I said, what are you talking about? And he said, the bike lane. It's a $400 ticket if you get caught riding in it, or you get caught in it. And it freaked me out. I mean, as much as parking in a handicap spot. All you gotta do is have one friend that gets a $400 ticket, and nobody else is gonna get one. So my question is to you, I'm sorry, what was your name from the DOT?
Russell.
What is the penalty or the fine for riding in one of these bike lanes that we're putting out there?
Thank you. And actually, Georgia Department of Transportation is not an enforcement agency, so law enforcement does not fall under our review. I do not know off the top of my head what is the penalty by law, but that's a regulatory enforcement issue.
Well, I got, one of my first days in California, I get introduced to that just because it's such a big fine. And we've had them for years here in Georgia, and I'm a cyclist, and I don't know the answer to the question either. I don't think anybody does, which is why they're always in them. So if you guys enforce the laws that you're putting out there, kept those bike lanes clean, it'd probably save headaches for everybody. Thank you.
Okay, from Alpharetta, Georgia, Mark Kinneman. And Curtis, did you bring Curtis with you, Mark?
I did not.
Are you Curtis?
Yeah, but I'm not with another gentleman.
Oh, okay. Thank you for pointing that out.
We didn't drive together.
Thank you.
I'm going to read a portion of the letter that I wrote to Representative Hill. And it starts with, "Dear Representative Hill, I'm an avid cyclist. I would like to think that Georgia would do everything possible to encourage bicycles as a green alternative modes of transportation, as well as for recreational riding. This piece of legislation will make it less safe for cyclists, as it will embolden motorized vehicle drivers to pass less safely and to share less of the road. Part of the reason cyclists prefer to ride two abreast is to alert vehicles behind them that the road is not safe for passing, except if they have a clear line of sight and can safely cross into the oncoming lane to pass. The proposal to limit groups to no more than four riders with a 50-foot gap between groups of four will lead to accidents between vehicles and bicycles, as the drivers will attempt to squeeze in and out between groups, as was so beautifully illustrated earlier today. The idea of allowing local governing authorities to restrict bicycle access to public roadways strikes me as un-American. My tax dollars support the construction of public roadways for all to use, not just those who wish to drive on them rather than ride on them. A better idea would be to begin to require all new roads built in Georgia to have bicycle lanes as part of the construction, and to increase the construction of protected bicycle lanes in the Atlanta metro area. Finally, requiring bicycle owners to register and obtain a license is nonsense. If people had wanted to register bicycles in Georgia, we would have implemented a bike registration program years ago. Many states or communities, as we've heard other people state tonight, are phasing out licensing programs as the revenue generated is not sufficient to cover the administrative expenses. So in closing, I want to emphasize my emphatic opposition to this poorly conceived piece of legislation."
I'll let you pronounce your last name. I think it's Billion. Billion?
That's close enough. It's a French name. It's Cajun. I'd like to talk about something that no one has ever brought up here in any of these meetings here so far. It's the constitutionality of this law. You know, Section 1 of the Constitution, Article 8, tells you that they have postal roads. And postal roads are where, this thing keeps going on. Postal roads are where all addresses are located out on homes. So the only thing during postal roads is that's why the postman has the right of way when you come to an intersection, because he has the right of way amongst all other vehicles. Well, anyway, y'all want to license us. Well, and y'all want to register, put registration on us too. Well, what people don't understand is that when they register something, they lose the right to it. They give it to the state, which is what you say in your bill, that if it's a bike owned by Georgia, would be subject to this law. Well, as soon as you put that license that says Georgia on it, they don't have the name of Georgia on there for nothing. It's because Georgia owns that bicycle now, not you. You have surrendered your property right to the state. Now, you still have an equitable right to use that bike, provided that you follow all the rules and regulations that your daddy, the state, now tells you, child, you can do and can't do. And if you don't follow them, I'll take the bike away from you and punish you. So I don't want to give my bike, my freedom, my liberty, and my property to the state. For no reason, ever. Now, in the Constitution, it tells you you have a right to freedom, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, but if people forget the right to property, the right to property. And without property, guess what? You have no freedom. And guess what? Without freedom, you have no liberty. Think about it. Anybody own a home around here?
Nope.
Nobody owns their house. You ever go down to the courthouse and look at your plat? Read it from cover to cover. You will never see the word own, O-W-N, in there. It ain't in there. It says to have it and to hold it, because you do not own it. You don't. So y'all need to understand something. Every time you legislators get up there, y'all swear to uphold the Constitution. But what do? Y'all go right to work, taking all our rights away from us. Because we're ignorant in our schools that y'all send us to that are government schools. And y'all don't teach us the Constitution. So we're stupid. We don't know any better. Our grandparents didn't know any better. Our great-grandparents were lied to. Our parents were lied to. And we don't know either. So we think this is okay. But it's not okay. So this law on its face is unconstitutional, and it's fraud. I want to say that. It's fraud. You're defrauding the people because they're ignorant. Because you forced them by mandate to send their children to school, which is the Board of Education who runs. Doesn't matter what kind of school you guys go to. It's the same curriculum. It's the same curriculum. Just that one school learns it better, they learn the lie better than the other school does. That's all. That's all it is. That's all it is. They don't teach you the Constitution in the school, because right away the children would say, well, teacher, this is not right. Y'all doing the wrong thing. You're looking in my locker and y'all telling me, you know, the strip search or whatever, you know, where's your warrant? Where's your warrant? You got no warrant. Okay? Because they're under license. That's the reason. You sign a contract and you agree to send them to school under, they would put the children in, they'd put you in prison if you didn't send your children there. They make that law mandatory, right? And so now you give them away to state, and then the state deceives them. And they grow up and come home and say, Daddy, I know everything. I'm smarter than you now. Right? Because I was an educator. But they... Are you right about that?
You got it.
We got you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Jim Saipan, are you about ready to speak?
Yeah.
Woohoo!
I probably ought to be able to talking to y'all rather than the legislature. I want to tell you all, I really do apologize if I've offended anybody in any way. I really don't know how I got to be
money.
Maybe the. Who said that? Raise your hand. Nobody said it? You said it, money?
Money.
What do you mean by that?
You got it, I didn't say it. I was just taking it up for whoever said it.
So, well, I think probably what you're talking about is wrong, like a lot of the other stuff is. The fact is, these guys up here, they're friends of mine because I've lived up here for over 40-something years. And I've contributed to their campaigns to the tune of a few hundred dollars. You can look it up. It's a matter of record. The one person that I know that's a real advocate for cyclists, which I'm glad for because I like you cyclists. I do. It's your bad ones I don't like. It's Casey Cagle. And I've given him $2,500 on all of his cycles.
Don't get mad at me, boys.
that's the truth, because he's a good legislator. I'm a little nervous because actually I'm 6'3", 70 years old, and I'm really afraid. And it's sad to me that I am afraid. I don't advocate to inhibit you guys. I don't advocate to put any undue pressure on you. I didn't write the law. I've emailed them every time I hear on television or in the paper that another cyclist has gotten killed, that we need to do something. I didn't say just to the cyclists. Maybe it's the auto drivers that we ought to. I'm a Harley guy. I ride my bike all the time. I love nature. I see and sit and talk with cyclists that don't know that I've been tagged as the whipping boy for this, which honestly, guys, I don't know why that's happened. I don't know how that happened. Chris and another fella and Dunahoo and I had lunch last year. I thought we had a pretty civil conversation. I think that we came to some agreement. I think that I haven't heard any more about it, or I know I hadn't heard any more about it, but I did hear him say tonight that they were moving in the direction to help educate some of the cyclists and the public. You know what I've learned tonight? I learned it earlier today from a guy that was working in my office. That I live on Clarksbridge Road, real curvy road. If you guys are from up here, you know about it. It's not very many places, two places from 52 to Lambstone Parkway to pass, and they're only about 150, 200 feet long. It's kind of hard to build up a big head of steam to pass people. So every evening, it's kind of stressful that I get behind a few bikes. But most of them are really, really good guys. They'll move over, they can see around the curve, they'll wave me around. Some aren't. But I've heard two automobile dealers tonight that have sort of, I don't know, been part of accusing me of being some kind of a bad guy or something that I'm really not. It's funny, I'm taking my wife to look at an Acadia GMC tomorrow. This weekend I plan on coming and maybe trying to trade my Ford for a Dodge truck. I'm probably going to do that. This is all the little clips that were in the Channel 11 thing, the terrible to my way of thinking journalism of the people that interviewed me, with the exception of one, left out the fact that I'm just concerned about everybody's health. I'm concerned about safety. I'm concerned. I'm a double lung transplant for 10 years. I take a lot of medication. If something happens to me and I go to the hospital and I don't have this little bracelet my wife gave me alerting them that I have a medical condition and have my driver's license so they can identify me, they may give me some medicine that would kill me, or they may not give me something that would save me because they didn't know what was wrong with me. Most of you guys don't carry any identification. Your bicycles don't have any identification. That's good. I was going to bring that up, and I see about 12 or 15 out of the, 50 or 60.
Right here. Mr. Seifert.
Okay, that's very, very good. That's good. That's good. That's good. And you know, I learned that today too, that they sell things like that. My wife gave me this because she loves me. Beg pardon?
Let him talk. Okay. Let him talk.
That's great. You guys are on the ball. I'm glad to hear that. I just can't figure for the life of me. What's got you guys so upset about registering your bikes? my Harley's registered. It's because I'm not one of you. Give me a break. I'm trying to understand. I really am trying to understand. I am sorry. I didn't mean to start this ruckus. I didn't do it. That's good.
Thank you. Bruno Rivera. We're pushing 10 minutes to 8 o'clock by my watch, so we've got a few more to go.
Hey guys, how you doing? Now, I got some speakers I like, some speakers I didn't like. Some mostly comes from the emotional side of things, and this is not what it's all about. For me, when it comes to jobs and bicyclists, it says that, let's see. It says that, do you know that more bicycle lanes increase the amount of sales for businesses on streets? In New York City, so as much as 47% in sales was seen since bike lanes was introduced. It makes economic sense to allow freedom of movement and travel. Another thing, speaking of bike lanes, it says that if what are you going to do to areas that has no bike lanes? Because this bill will make it illegal to ride a bike anywhere without a license. And a short introduction about myself. My name is Bruno Rivera. I'm field coordinator for Brian Sudinski. And another thing, he's a good friend of mine. He has a family of 6 children. And according to this bill, it says that in only 4 riders can ride in a lane. So which one out of his 6 children are you legislator going to be allowed in discriminating 3 of them? It doesn't make sense to me that we cannot come to a conclusion where it's us, the individuals, and private property owners and businesses can create opportunities in where we educate the public that way. Legislations in Congress and people of government, they're there to enforce the Constitution, not to enforce the people. All right? And so, for me, it's all about individual freedom, freedom of travel, and that's the reason why people are fed up with this bill. Not because of the emotional side of things, it's because what's exactly in this bill. I don't know how many pages there are in this bill, but there's a lot of bad stuff in there, and it's unfair. And so basically, it is ridiculous that you will require a license plate on every bicycle, even a child's bicycle, costing family monies, time, and hassle every year. We cannot allow our children to have a lemonade stand in public property. Do you guys need any more of our money? Yeah. Now you do. There you go. You got honesty. But thank you for your time. Thank you.
Davis is from North Hawk County. And
I live up in the prime area for cyclists. See them all the time. They come down Brady Road, great route. It's a good road to ride. It's curvy and hilly and all this stuff. And I've never had a problem with them. But there is a problem, but it can't be solved. You're going to have to get a small group together. Forget driver's license and tags. That's overreach of the government. Just can that part. But I read the law 689 3 or 4 times. Strengthen part of it. Change 4 abreast to no more than 2. I'd say 1 on certain roads. Mount Vernon Road is a great one to cycle on. Maybe cycle early on Sunday morning, early Saturday morning. But there's certain roads you shouldn't cycle on. And you and I can sit here, I-75, I-20, 365, and we all agree you don't want to get on that with a bicycle.
They're already got the law.
Well, it may be, but I'm just saying there's roads. I was ran off the road Saturday a week ago, coming 52 from Dahlonega. I live right at the Lumpkin County line, and a guy was trying to pass 2 cyclists abreast. And when he did, he got in my lane, and I left the road to keep him hitting him head on. And I mean, I left the road. So now, this is a driver issue, but I'm saying, you need to spread the line out. Mount Vernon Road's got 2 places you pass on. One's at Ben Parks, and one's just southbound of North Hall School, 150, 200 feet. But now I passed in other places if I can see, because as the cyclists go up the hill, they slow down. And sometimes they'll wave you around, but I don't really go for that because I don't know how well they like me. Right now, county commissioners do not like me.
So I probably not going to pay much attention to it either.
But anyway, take the law you have now, and you got law in that in 689 that pertains to cycling. Take that scratch driver's license and all that. That's overreach. Designate certain roads and times for cycling. And we agree. Well, I'm just trying to protect you from me. I got a big brush guard. You'll lose. If you and I tangle up, you lose. I've gone all over the place to keep from hitting somebody, and I think that'd be the worst thing I could do if I hit somebody on a cycle. And I don't cycle. I'm 75, and probably halfway down the road, I'd have a heart attack.
3 minutes again, sir.
Okay. The dog issue they brought up, I've talked to my neighbors in North Hall, telling them their dogs run loose. They run out and cause one of the bicyclers to hit it, swerve, miss, have a wreck. You're going to get sued. They'll own your house, your car, and everything. And we've got a great animal control here in Hall County. Mike Ledford does it. I've called on him a number of times. But the dog issue is a biggie for cyclers, because I see my neighbor's dog. I said, they're going to make a cycler have a problem, and they're going to sue you, if for no other reason. So this can all be fixed, but it's got to be in a smaller group. People from this group, people from, and by adding lanes, guess who's got to pay for them? Me, the homeowner. So if you want to put a tax on all bicycle parks and bicycles to pay for this extended lane, that may be a good way to approach it.
Thank you, Doctor. We're about to run up on 8 o'clock. Is there anybody else that wants to, has to say something in your name, sir?
Bill Young.
All right, Bill, will you come to the mic? And Mike Scooping will get you next. So, in your name, sir? You were. Okay.
Thank you very much, sir, gentlemen. I'll be very brief. What upset me about hearing this, and the reason I'm here tonight, I just moved to Hall County, to Georgia, July 1st of 2012. I'm 58. I lived 57 years of my life in New York State. Why did I leave New York State after 57 years? Because the state is run by Democrat liberal socialists. Trying to be amusing. It was a life-changing event, moving. I know I talk funny. But the point is, it got to the point where I would call our legislators and they wouldn't even listen to me because they knew they were going to get reelected because of the way the people are there. When I saw this law come up, what I saw was, in New York State, everything is either illegal, taxed to death, or you have to have a license for it. I moved here because I thought that this would be a place where this is not going to continue to grow, this licensing and taxing, taxing and taxing. I'm not a cyclist. I don't own a bicycle, and I don't plan on buying one. The reason I'm talking here tonight is about the fact that America needs to belong to the people, and the people need to have the right to be able to put their children or themselves on a bicycle and bicycle without having to pay a tax and have a license, and have more infringement on their rights. That's the reason I wanted to speak, because I'm concerned. I like it here, I like the people here, I'm glad I moved here, but I am a conservative, and I'm here by choice. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
My name is Mike Scooping, and I guess you'd call me a constitutional conservative. I represent Lanier Tea Party Patriots, and one of the things I approached these three gentlemen sitting at the desk about with this was my concern about what it could lead to. Those suspicions now have already been confirmed by the gentleman sitting at the end. I'm very much concerned over our nation. The Tea Party stands for fiscal responsibility, constitutionally limited government, and free markets. When you start taxing and passing regulations, you're hindering all three of those. When I had never even heard of complete streets before tonight, so I sat back here and I Googled complete streets to find out what it is. From what I saw online, the majority of the money to make streets complete comes from the federal government. So that was the very thing that I spoke to Carl before this meeting that concerned me, is that the federal government getting involved in the state of Georgia through this issue, which really is an issue that needs to be talked about, but we don't need the federal government involved in it making complete streets or anything else. If we want to raise taxes in this state, in Hall County, or in the city of Gainesville to do these streets and add bike lanes, I'm all for that. I'm 100% for that. But if we're going to look to the federal government to give us money with a $17 trillion debt to provide bike lanes, there's something wrong with everybody sitting in this room. Yeah. And that's all I got to say.
I've been asked to respond to the federal government part of that. Just so you know, every time you fill up a gallon of gas, 18.4 cents goes to Washington, D.C. of your money in the form of a gas tax, motor fuel tax, 22 cents for diesel. That money comes back to Georgia by a formula amount to be used on transportation projects. So that is the federal gas tax and motor fuel tax that goes to Washington. It does come back. Georgia Department of Transportation uses that money with the state gas tax, which is 7.5 cents and 4% sales tax, to match. You have to match the money. Usually 80% of that's federal, 20% of that is state to match. But that is how we provide transportation improvements for all projects, no matter what it is throughout Georgia.
Georgia is less than
the CW. We are a donor state, that's correct. Yes, sir. If you'll tell us who you are.
Yeah, my name is Harry Abrams. I live in Cherokee County. Okay. It's right at the border of Cobb and Bartow. You all are welcome to come to Cherokee County and ride your bikes and also enjoy the Silver Comet Trail.
Yeah.
In the course of human events, legislatures sometimes forget who and what they are, such as the case with House Bill 689, a very non-Republican way of imposing way of imposing more government into our daily lives than we need. I am copying the five representatives, or have copied the five Republican representatives in Cherokee County in the hope that some semblance of rational logic will let them prevail upon their colleagues here in this county, so as not to incur what will be a virtual firestorm of ridicule upon their Gainesville brethren. Rather, you should look at legislation that should be removed from the statutes that spend more time on this issue. Again, this has been commented before, this is really not the appropriate venue for it. And after reading both the bill and the existing Georgia legislation concerning bikes, it definitely is not. As we all pray for some common sense, so we do hope it is delivered. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, he's speaking next. Thank you. Okay. Why don't you come on up?
Can you hear me from there?
I can't, but come on up. And just...
All right.
Thank you very much for the privilege to speak. Let me just start here. I want to ask all you gentlemen a categorical question. You don't have to answer it. I don't expect you to, but I would request that you respectfully consider taking your bill and pulling it before it's considered.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think that none of us expecting what happened here tonight. I want to think optimistically that you gave us this opportunity, everyone here, and you fully expected a lot of voices tonight and a lot of diverse opinion. I don't think we got a lot of diverse opinion. I think we got a lot of opinion that's running down the same road. And I want to show you an example of an inconsistency that involves me. I'm 72 years old and I race bikes. I used to be a marathon runner and my knees took off and so I started cycling. Several weeks ago, I took first in the road race and second in the time trial in 70 and over. And guess where it was? Warner Robins. It was a state sanctioned, supported event called Georgia Golden Olympics. It was on open roads. We were fortunate enough to have the entire road, and I needed it. We had some accidents. Somebody tapped my rear wheel, and I just looked quickly and lost half the field. We had one gentleman that said, he was 90, and he said, you know what? There's two ways to win a race. You can ride faster, or you can outlive them. So, with that, I want someone talked about the constitutional, they talked about liberty, and for those of you that are familiar with American jurisprudence, in the first volume of American jurisprudence, it expands on, of all things, the Declaration of Independence, and it applies it to transportation. And if I may, I just want to be very brief. It's found, for those that are interested, in the constitutional law, section 329, page 1135. It says, in American jurisprudence, we read, personal liberty largely consists of the right to locomotion, to go where and when one pleases, only so far restrained as the rights of others may make it necessary for the welfare of all other citizens. The right of the citizen to travel upon the public highways and to transport his property thereon by horse-drawn carriage, remember this was written in 1939, wagon or automobile is not a mere privilege which may be permitted or prohibited at will, but the common right which he has under his right to liberty, life, and the pursuit of happiness. Under this constitutional guarantee, one may therefore, under normal conditions, travel at his inclination along the public highways or in public places, and while conducting himself in an orderly and decent manner, neither interfering with nor disturbing another's rights, he will be protected not only in his person, but in his safe conduct. It behooves us as automobile drivers and as cyclists to be responsible. And I welcome this opportunity for this to be the first of meetings that we can have with civility, with construction, and hopefully out of that we can come with improvement. Don't you think so?
Amen.
Yes, amen.
And your name, sir?
My name is Dick Yellner. I live in Forsyth County. I have two comments. First, we all have a problem. Problem number one is texting. This afternoon, I did a 6-mile short bicycle ride. I was going northbound on John Down Road. Some woman ended up going southbound, right? Texting, whoo! I had to go over in the ditch. The second one is both Cumming and Gainesville have a Hispanic problem. If you've seen the Hispanics ride their bicycles, they ride on the wrong side of the road. There's no education to these individuals. DeKalb County, the same thing. Those are two problems that you guys can solve. Eliminate texting and educate the Hispanics. Also, I have from the American Cycling Association economic impact statements. I'll give each one of you guys a copy.
Thank you. Anybody else want to speak?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Can you tell us your name, please, sir?
Where sure. You Mark Lindenberg, Atlanta. Oh, yeah. Just some things about some statistics. Obviously, talking about registration, we do border with wonderful states, Alabama, Tennessee, South Carolina, Florida. People cross the state. How are you going to handle those people? People biking through the state. People, again, coming to charity rides within the state. Another item, HB 689, talks about restricting, obviously, cyclists, potentially time of day or streets or just the actual activity. Currently, 64.8% of Georgia adult population is either overweight or obese. That leads to massive healthcare costs that we have to pay as a state. Cycling reduces those healthcare costs. Currently, 40% of Georgia's youth is either overweight or obese. I know one of the sponsors is a doctor. You know where that ranks us in the entire 50 states? 49th. We beat one. Why do we want an activity to ban or limit or prohibit activity? What about kids that are able to bike to school, elementary or high school, middle school? Only four at a time? We're gonna have shuttles? Okay, you four go. Let's wait. Everybody hold back. Next four go after a couple minutes? Really? Okay, let's wait. Hold back. Oh, your mother's here. You get to go, but you know, your two brothers, you know, you can't bring your friends. I mean, the thought process. I don't know how bills are created. They say it's like sausage. But shouldn't you like have all the parties of the sausage before like it comes out versus just like the parts you don't want to mention? Other thing is with the spacing, currently four cyclists take 12 feet to ride. That's how much space they need riding two abreast with approximately a foot in between them, which is normal. Average mid-sized car is 13 and a half feet. Four cyclists with the new law is now 34 feet with the spacing. Talk about cars that want to go around, sir. Imagine 12 feet versus 34 feet. Your problem becomes much worse with that spacing. Nine cyclists, current spacing is 31 feet, which is less than two cars following each other on the road. The new law, 173 feet. Even worse, there's group rides. And some group rides are large. I'm from Atlanta. 50 cyclists, current law, 161 feet, about half the length of a football field. That might seem like a lot. The reality is, that's the distance from three cars traveling at 40 miles per hour. It's not that far. The new law with 50 cyclists, 663 feet, 2.25 football fields. Imagine going around and going around and going around. Talk about swerves and hitting and oncoming traffic. It's impossible. You're basically banning. And I'll finish with this. Cycling, I met my spouse through cycling. I've been cycling a long, long time. I'm also a volunteer advisor at Emory University. I give back. I have seen people lose weight, get healthier. Again, I don't get paid for it. It's a volunteer. I'm an alumni. And I helped start the club. I promote the club. And I've seen many people change their lives. It's actually pretty rewarding. But cycling, besides being an activity and passion of mine, a lot of people like things that they enjoy to do and they want to do it, such as I know some of the sponsors are avid golfers or fishermen. Great activities, nothing against that. Imagine me talking to some other, if I'm a congressperson, saying, you know what? The pass on golf courses or going to fishing, I'm gonna limit four people per group. And you know what? They can't talk to their spouse or friend while they're doing their activity, only single file. I mean, the reality is two abreast allows people to talk, allows people to chat. It's very safe. If you've ever driven a car, I'm sure you've talked to your passenger. I mean, it's the same type of thing. You're enjoying the outdoors. I know the sponsors like the outdoors. Trout fishermen, golfers, little league coach, talking to people. The aspect of cycling is also very social besides being healthy. You talk to the person. You're potentially, with HB 689, is reducing and limiting, I'm almost done, the ability to ever talk to someone why they're enjoying a beautiful time. Imagine the golf cart never talking to your friend. Thank you for understanding some of our concerns. We appreciate the time.
Thank you. My name is Joe Todd, and I live in Suwannee. And you probably didn't recognize me, but I was one of the cyclists in the diagram at the very end. I was on the group probably with Jim and some of the other guys. We've had a lot of comments this evening, and you know, much of what I had to say has been talked about already. But obviously, I've been riding for over 32 years, starting in Atlanta. I traveled, I lived overseas for a number of years. I rode in Germany, I rode in Japan, Spain, several other countries as well. I think we can learn something, not about politics perhaps, or the way we set up our economic system, but certainly about cycling and the attitude between the motorist and the cyclist in general. But one of the things that I noticed was that many of the people who got up here, like myself, I've been hit by a car. They've had accidents. And I would just, out of curiosity, how many of the cyclists in this room have been hit by a car? It's quite a number. So obviously what you have here is people with a lot of passion for this sport because they love it. It's a freedom that very few other sports offer. You get to move and you get to travel. And you do it and it's healthy. And I would hate to think that we're going to limit that ability for people in future generations. I mean, once we pass something like this, I can see that maybe North Carolina or South Carolina, Alabama, and some of the other states are also looking at this and saying, is this a good direction for us to go? I raced for several years. One of my friends was hit and killed in Cumming, Georgia in 2002. A guy named Dave Martin was one of the fastest sprinters I've ever seen. He wasn't a pro, but he would typically beat the pros. He trained for 3 weeks and go up to North Carolina, and everybody would be talking about, you know, the announcers say, oh, here comes so-and-so, here comes so-and-so. And Dave would sit in the pack and burst out at the very end and win the race. If you do away with pack rides, you take away that competitive aspect as well. And that's something that we all enjoy also. Most of the other comments have already been made. Thank you for your time.
My name is Joe Elam. I'm speaking, all these cyclists have spoke everything I wanted to say as far as from the cycling world. I thank all these cyclists for being here. Cycling is my life. This is what puts my kids through school, gets my wife her shoes she wants. This law would ask me to unemploy 6 Georgians, and every other bicycle shop owner here would be in the same boat. Gainesville has just opened a brand new sporting goods store I know each of you guys are probably very proud of, Dick's. They sell bicycles. So this law is just no good for the economy.
Thank you. Come on up, Captain. This is Mr. Calvin Stewart.
Thanks for the introduction. Fred's, I own 2 redneck bicycles. Bought at a yard sale. I use them on back streets, me and my little girl. Don't ride them on the highway. All this boils down to tonight is folks like me who don't ride in the mountains, don't ride on the state highways. I want to get to where I'm going. If I got a funeral to go to, I want to get there on time. If I got a wedding to go to, I want to get there on time. If I want to go to work, I want to get there on time. Friends, if I'm driving down the road in my car with a few folks sitting next to me chit-chatting and having a good time, and I'm driving 20, 25, maybe 30 miles an hour, and y'all trying to get to work, you're trying to go to a funeral, you're trying to go to a wedding, and I'm not letting you get by on that hilly, curvy road, you know what's gonna happen? Your knuckles are gonna get white. I'm probably gonna be called some names. Why don't that blankety blank get out of my way? And I'm talking about you and your automobile. You're trying to get to work. That's how common folks like me feel when I run up on a group of bicyclists that I can't get around. Now, I've heard I like to ride side by side where we can talk and have a good time. Good. I have no heartburn with any of y'all having a good time. I just want to get to where I want to go.
Leave earlier.
How early do I have to leave?
We're common folks too, bro.
How early do I have to leave? Do I have to leave 15 minutes early to get around you?
How do you get around a farm tractor?
And then get around another group
down the
road?
How do you get around a postman?
School bus.
School bus.
How about somebody with a handicap?
School buses stop and generally make turns. They get off the highway. They go down residential streets. We all know that.
They're going straight.
Now, y'all know the reason you're here is probably a lot of complaints. Those people complaining aren't here tonight. And I've walked up here and put myself out to speak for all these folks that are hadn't showed up tonight. Now, my suggestion is, to all you good folks out there that like to have fun, ride bicycles. God bless you. Spend your money. I'm happy for you. Have fun. But come together and come up with a means or some ideas that other folks like me can travel up and down the highway without having to be hung up for long periods of time. End of story.
Driver's education. Go back and take a driving course.
You take a driving course, buddy. I don't need your smart mouth.
Okay, thank you, Michael. Thank you. We need to keep it down a little bit, okay? All right, we have another speaker here.
Hey, y'all. I'll be real brief. I'm just a regular guy who likes to take my 2.5-year-old daughter to daycare 3 times a week by bicycle in Athens. My name is Brent Bice. I'm the executive director of Georgia Bikes. I appreciate the kind words that were said about us, and I appreciate y'all having this forum about this important issue. I'm glad that everybody's here with the common ground of safety. Ultimately, I see this as a local issue that demands a local response and not sweeping state legislation. And on behalf of Georgia Bikes, what I would like to do is offer to help coordinate a local task force to talk about bike safety issues, to bring those obviously upset folks who are driving, as well as folks who just want to get back to their toddler daughters and their wives and their loved ones, whether they're riding a bike for transportation like I do or for recreation like many of my friends and colleagues here tonight. I encourage y'all to visit with me afterwards, encourage you to become a member and support bike advocacy so we can do this kind of safety education for all roadway users. And I definitely want to thank Mr. McMurry and the Georgia Department of Transportation for their great work on working to make the roads accessible for everybody. Appreciate y'all's time.
Hi, I'm Zach Renling, and I'm from Decatur, Georgia. I just want to say HB 689 is a step in the wrong direction for Georgia and the country. As many states move to encourage and support cycling as an environmentally friendly, healthy activity, I'm astonished that I find myself here trying to convince our lawmakers of its benefits. In a time of congested roadways and ever-increasing traffic in the metro Atlanta area, rather than applaud and support cyclists trying to reduce cars on the road, as well as our carbon footprint, our lawmakers are attempting to bully cyclists off the road with this impending legislation. Now cyclists are being told that if they want to jump on a bike to pick up some groceries, grab a cup of coffee, or just get some exercise, they must first seek governmental approval. We can't convince Georgians to come to an agreement on the registration of guns, and yet bikes are now on the chopping block as a public threat. Let's call this bill what it is, a backward solution to a growing problem. The current problem is that the roads today can't handle the influx of cyclists, and like it or not, we aren't going away. Rather than having a discussion about expanding our roadways to account for cyclists and making Georgia bike friendly, this bill isn't designed to intimidate cyclists so they no longer feel welcome riding where the simple joy of jumping on a bike and going for a ride has been obscured by red tape. There are plenty of laws that already mandate how cyclists should behave and properly assimilate themselves into traffic. Most people's issue with bikes on the road is not their presence, but with how a small few act. This issue is poor enforcement of existing laws, and it won't be solved with registration. The purpose of requiring registration and licensing for motor vehicles is their inherent danger. It is important to assure that the driver accepts the responsibility one must take when they sit behind the wheel of a 2-ton hunk of metal flying 80 miles an hour down the road. Until our publicly elected politicians are prepared to have a serious dialogue about how cyclists and motorists can share the road, and sharing is an operative word here, we'll be left with suggestions such as HB 689. If this is the point we're at, why not designate the road for car use Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and for bikes Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday? And then Sunday can stay how it is, with an open season for cyclists.
Anybody else? Okay, I gotta go to the bathroom here.
I just have a quick 30 seconds. I'm Jeff Branion. I'm a 23-year law enforcement veteran in North Georgia, and I would just ask, before you guys do this, this is almost impossible to enforce from a law enforcement perspective. So if you're going to do something, please engage somebody in law enforcement and say, hey, look, if we're going to pass more legislation that we're going to make you guys enforce, let's get somebody in on the front end of it to talk about how that's practical and applicable. There's nothing safe about this. I'm a cyclist. I have three children that are cyclists. This makes cycling less safe, and it's going to be incredibly difficult for us to enforce.
What you just said. One of the things I do want to bring out, a week ago I was at Unicoi DNR Day. Had the privilege of speaking to several forest rangers, DNR rangers, and every single one of them said the same thing. Man, it's really dangerous up here in the mountains. The bikers are everywhere, but we have nothing against these bikers. The cyclists, we enjoy seeing them, and what are we going to do to get each group to understand that there's a danger zone there? And I think Chad hit some great points about educating people. That's the only reason that I put my name on this bill. The only reason is for safety, but it's to educate. And Chad brought up great points. You can boo or whatever you want. That's fine. That's the only reason, and I'm telling you that. The biggest thing is each one of them made the comment, have you ever had, they know I fish, I have a bass boat, I travel all over the country. I, last year, coming from Lake Burton, come around a curve about 15 miles an hour, and there's six cyclists. They're doing nothing wrong, nothing. But at that time, it's hard to stop a trailer and a boat, so I had to make a choice. I had to. I could either run over them, I could go down the ditch, and I'm gonna win if I went over them. We all understand that. But then I can swerve around, which I chose to do because there was an open lane. As I go down around the curve, there's six more. They're still doing nothing wrong. What I want to know, and what these guys are saying, you know, we're out here every day. We can't enforce what you said, the law. But they did weigh out and say, we need to work together to figure out by education how we can solve these problems, because statistics are, they're up. And you said that. The biggest thing, again, is law enforcement. I talked to Hall County yesterday. I talked to several, and they said the same thing. Said, man, it's great exercise. We do it. We love it. But we're going to have to start doing something for the few rebels in anything we do. If it's a bass tournament, we have rebels that cause a bad name for the tournament. Whatever we do, cycling, all I asked is the education part is to carry it on to the bicycle shops, to the rallies. And our lieutenant governor, trust me, is gonna be hearing to where he needs to have rallies, step forward, and he needs to commit his passion to make sure that there's communication. And I do thank you, again, before you speak, I really do appreciate it. Some of you in the look, there's no need when you have your 2 cents to act like children and boo somebody. Everybody's entitled to say what they feel. That's why we're having a meeting here of constituents with two different needs. But I do thank you again, and I do mean that. Thank you very much.
I got my name's Johnny Dixon, and I'd like to, just from my heart, I got something I need to say. A few years back, the job I used to do, we used to donate stuff to people in need. We used to buy groceries, take it to them, bicycles, clothes, whatever they needed. I retired 2.5 years ago from my job. I started repairing bicycles. Some I'd put out in the front yard, some I'd put up in the garage. Come Christmas time, I'd find any family I'd donate to them. Because some people can't afford bicycles. I was going through Chicopee Mill one day, seen two kids on bicycles, one kid running his little heart out, trying to keep it with him. I just happened to bought 3 bicycles in the back of my truck in yard sales. I pull over and give the kid one, and give them my business card at the time, because I was employed. and told him, I said, when you get home, your mom won't spank you for stealing this bicycle. Tell her to call me. About 6:30 at night, I received the phone call. The lady asked me, did you give my son a bicycle? I said, yes, ma'am. If he needs any work done on it, call me. I'll come by just to see you, whatever. She started crying. She said, I have been trying to save money for 6 months to buy my son a bicycle. Every time I save money to buy him a bicycle, I can't because I had to spend on something else. Now, that's what I do. I've even thought, sit down the other night, I talked to some friends of mine that ride bikes. One used to own a bike shop, about trying to get something in Hall County where kids come to somewhere and learn how to fix their own bikes and have some kind of mentoring on bicycles. By y'all, this bill doing what it's doing, the people I try to help, they can't buy a bicycle, sure can't buy a tag. I appreciate you if y'all would consider that. That's my point, and thank you very much for coming and having this time.
Very quickly, my name's Stephen Dean. I live in South Hall, Flowery Branch area. I didn't really want to come up here. It's a little intimidating even for my taste, but look, I'm former law enforcement 5 years. I'm sorry it's not more. I'm young. But truth be told also, I vote for what it's worth, not getting partisan politics. I do vote Republican, conservative. When I first heard of this bill, I was a little disappointed, guys. I thought it was coming from the left. I really did. Couple reasons why, not just to throw, I'm not throwing insults. I still believe in you. I have no animosity towards any of you. I make 5 mistakes a day. It's okay. But truth be told, don't let your concern for other people's safety to extent control their freedom. That's tyrannical government at its best or worse. We don't want that. That's the main thing. When we throw our leg over that bike, we understand the risk we take, just like why I used to put that gun and that badge on. I understood, well, I could get shot tonight. I still made that decision. We don't want to get ran over. We want y'all to do what you can to help ensure our safety. But this country's been founded on freedom first, even at all costs. Keep that in mind. I appreciate it.
Let me tell you the reason this bill was dropped last week of March, and I know most of you don't like it, was to get everybody in this room. We continue to have concerns on either side. The main thing I heard tonight was education. We need to be polite. We need to do more of it because it's good for us. And we all need to be good citizens, good Georgians, and good Americans. This bill will be pulled first thing in the morning. There will be no further action done on this bill. Mention one other thing. I know many of you are veterans, many of you have children in the armed forces. My wife and I have a son in the military, had some issues, but I got an email from the West Point from a Major Brian Montgomery, Major Army Infantry, and he said, Representative Rogers, if we don't have cycling or if we hinder cycling, we cannot heal our troops from post-traumatic stress. So that's very touching, and I've gotten thousands of emails. Rest assured, nothing else will be done on this bill. We need to communicate, we need to work together. I want to thank you for being here, for your time, and the other reps, and Russell McMurry for making a beeline up here from Atlanta. And let's work together, be good Georgians, and be friendly to everyone. Thank you.
Education. That was to have